Alright, hello and welcome to another episode of Nui Sports TV. I'm Ty Stedman. This is episode 7 for the 2017 pre-season and season. Let's get right into it tonight. Over the weekend, 3 match days to talk about, the first of which is a very small match day featuring Cessnock City against West Wallsend in the junior grades only. Cessnock not able to field a 19s team on the day due to various reasons, so they pulled out last week in the 19s. So under 15s and 17s were the only games on. Under 15s ended 7-0 to West Wallsend, and the under 17s ending 2-0 to West Wallsend. I could look up the goal scorers, but they are available on the West Wallsend Facebook page, and I think I also shared them, so not sure off the top of my head. Blake Chiapara did get one, I know that much, for West Wallsend. For Cessnock, with early days, no real comments there about those results or anything. West Wallsend looking good in both those grades, though. We move on to some NPL action, which is very rare here on Nui Sports, as you can tell by these logos. We don't do much NPL around these parts, but we do in pre-season, and this pre-season was Valentine Phoenix versus the Edgeworth Eagles. There you go, so those can be just chucked over there. A couple of props. Don't need a team wore their actual kits. Away kits, there's all sorts of problems. Apparently orange clashes with red now, and then I got home and watched Liverpool and Wolverhampton, so I don't know about orange clashing with red. But anyway, enough of the kit crap. Kit crap, that's all it is. Under 18's result, Valentine FC 0, defeated by the Edgeworth Eagles 3. It didn't take long for Valentine's defence to crumble under early pressure. Edgeworth started quickly, got a tap in through Sam Russell at the back post. Good header by Jackson Rush into that goal. The first of a lot of tap-ins over the match day. Edgeworth, as I said, better side. Valentine looking to turn momentum, and that they did. Just before half-time, they sort of got their way back into the match, but they weren't really they weren't really getting it going forward. They lacked going forward. Harry Wills scored the second goal for Edgeworth, someone, you know, pretty well known here on Nui Sports from his time at Cahiba last year. Another fairly easy tap in, and then Connor Cusack also got a goal, an easy goal. We'll talk about Valentine. They need to sort of look to improve, and I think they will. It's still very early days. I think a lot of new players in that squad. I was talking to people who've had something to do with the squad. I don't know too much about NPL 18s, or I guess it was 17s last year, but some decent players, some decent individual players, whether they can coexist, not coexist, but whether they can combine well as a team is a crucial piece of the puzzle. Edgeworth, too good on the day, two wingers, Tyrone Patterson, Anton Fenwick, really standing out. Good size, good speed, good ability. And they'll be two to watch this year for the Edgeworth under-18s team, which is looking really good at this stage of the season. Under-20s, Valentine 1, drawing Edgeworth FC 1. If this game was a sign of things to come for the under-20s, a new look under-20s for the NPL, then I'm definitely looking forward to hearing about it. It's good to see a lot of young players in both squads. The game played out fairly evenly. Fairly hot conditions, I'm not going to lie. I'm still probably sunburnt from last week, and even more sunburnt yesterday at Mark's Point. A beautiful, beautiful place, Mark's Point. The field, probably not the greatest in the world, but nice little day by the lake. Ain't too bad in my opinion. We came home the long way by Belmont Lakeside, which is not normally somewhere I see very often. I don't normally go out to the lake, so it's nice to get out there. It's, you know, it's a beautiful part of the world out there. As I said, fairly even, and then the breakthrough came just after half time. Mark Finlayson giving Valentine a lead. Their lead looked the goods. They played really well, Valentine, against a good Edgeworth side, but Josh Chiarelli would get one back. exciting youngster, definitely one to watch at Edgeworth. Jackson Lundy as well on the opposite side, very good. Both very exciting players. They did. I think they also had someone up front that was, again, a player who probably wasn't, you know, the same size as some of these defenders that they were playing. You know, these players are good, but they're not actually physically strong just as yet. Physically commanding, I guess, is the word I'm looking for. So that will be the test for them, whether they can size up to a few of these big defenders throughout the NPL under-20s. Lots of international football school players sprinkled throughout Edgeworth's lower two grades, so good to see. Good to see a lot of talent coming out of there, and I think you will over the years. Coasties or not, it's a good program. For Valentine, Caleb Pearson, arguably their best on the day, kept busy in midfield. Good in defence, really, really strong in defence. I remember watching him play a couple of years back in UFM when Valentine was still in UFM, playing as fullback. This was more midfield, this was a commanding performance and great vision as well. Top effort by Valentine to get the draw there. In first grade, unfortunately for the Phoenix, it fell apart here. Valentine 1, defeated by Edgeworth 5. A gusting wind came across the ground, which was nice. It cooled the temperatures down a lot. Same today at Maitland, we'll talk about that soon. Both teams, you know, had to keep that in mind about the wind. For Edgeworth, a few out. I don't want to comment on who was out because they may have left the club. I don't know. Brody Taylor, as far as I'm concerned, is still at Edgeworth. I'm forgetting others. There were others. Aaron McLaughlin starting on the bench, who was normally starting last year. There was a few out, okay, and there's a lot of youngsters in. Daniel McBream's not one of those youngsters, unfortunately, not anymore. Still plays very well, doesn't he? Aiden Bryce, Brent Hamill, Pat Wheeler, all among the Edgeworth regulars. Adam Corley made a start, and Josh Lowe, the young goalkeeper, started in goals. For Valentine, Scott Carter, the infamous Scott Carter from Adamstown Rosebud, a goalkeeper who's just, for better or worse, someone to watch. He's had good days and he's had very bad days between the sticks. He's just a real character of NPL football in Newcastle, isn't he? And that's not being derogatory either. He's a good goalkeeper on his day, but he's made some horror mistakes in the past and didn't have a great day yesterday. Let's talk about it. Dan Bartlett also played for Valentine, and Daniel Miners also started against his former side. Even first half, testing conditions, as I said. McBreen and Chris Fayers, that is, really hard to deal with. It wasn't going to be easy for Valentine. Scott Carter kept busy. They're definitely going to get some ball boys there at Valentine. Seeing Scott Carter have to chase the ball, and it was really slowing the game down a lot. That could be something they could look into. Jokes aside, Adam Crawley was threatening the Valentine defence, and it's Chris Fayers who got the first goal for Edgeworth. Moments later, I was writing down Fayers scores a goal, I was typing stuff down, just making sure that everything was written down for that goal, and then I missed Daniel McBreen's goal. I just looked up and he chipped it over the keeper. Apparently it was a mistake from Carter in goals. Then Josh Lowe gifted one for Edgeworth, the young goalkeeper, gifting Dan Bartlett a goal. Daniel McBreen, though, scored a tap-in after some great build-up play by Bailey Maxton. He had a good game yesterday. And a quick assist from Chris Fayers. Things would only get worse for Darren Seals' side. Another Scott Carter mistake, and Bailey Maxton made it 4-1. And then a penalty against, penalty to Aidan Gardner against Scott Carter, converted by Maxton. Edgeworth far too good. Let's talk real quickly about Edgeworth. Damien Zane would be delighted with the result. They had players out, and they performed in that style at this stage of the season. So a lot to look forward to for Edgeworth. I was going to try and catch an interview with Daniel McBreen, just for the hell of it, just to say that I did it. He was in a bit of a hurry, Macca, so that was unfortunate. But one of the questions I was going to ask him is, where to now for Edgeworth? Because where do you go from the season last year? You know, do you go try and one step further in the FFA Cup? Do you try and win the NPL knockouts? Of course, they're defending the title. Edgeworth, massive team, massive club on the rise. Well, not on the rise, they are there at the mountaintop. For Valentine, a lot of work needed. Still early days, but definitely not a good day at the office for Valentine. And in that, we will take a little break here. I'm going to send it over to myself. And in case you haven't seen it yet, I caught up, was fortunate enough to catch up with Valentine FC head coach Darren Sills. Here it is. Hi, I'm here with Darren Sills from Valentine FC, the head coach here at Valentine. First of all, how's pre-season going, mate?
Yeah, it's been going really well, Todd. We've slowly building towards our start of the season, 11th of March, and it's an extended season this year with Lakes coming in. So, yeah, Everyone's had to start early, which is what we've done.
Yeah. For any outsiders watching this, what's Valentine aiming for in the NPL? This year, and I guess over the next 3 years, what's Valentine all about, I guess?
Yeah, well, obviously we're one of the largest, or if not the largest, Latin Corusian club within that shire.
Yeah.
We've got over 1,200 players and coaches and members within that group, so there's a lot of onus, a lot of pressure on me to perform with the first grade squad.
Yeah.
So we're looking to try and fit in the top. Obviously this year the top half of the league if we can, and then and improve from there. It's a building process. We're one of the few clubs we've got around 7 or 8 local juniors playing in our top 20 players, so we've got a lot of locals that we've drawn on. That's something we're proud of, and we'll continue to do that. However, we do know we still need to get quality into the club, which is what we're trying to do.
Talk about quality, bringing in Scott Carter, obviously a very experienced goalkeeper at the back.
Yeah, he is, and Scotty's he's well known for all these probably all the wrong things with Scott, but he's a tremendous player himself. He's a great guy off the pitch. I think he needed to change, and he's been outstanding with us, although he didn't go great today.
It wasn't a great day today,
but he's a very likeable fella, a good character, and someone that commands and is intimidating in his presence at the back, and that's what we're after.
Yeah, obviously the result didn't matter today against Edgeworth, but was it good to test yourselves against the region's probably top side in the NPL?
Yeah, but you'd have to be naive to think that was their top side. They had a number of their imports out, and we mixed and matched during the two grades, and at the end of the day, it's a hit out, it's a trial. There was no injuries, and at the end of the day, that's what we're looking at.
Yeah, is it good having, I guess, a guaranteed 3-year window in the NPL? No relegation. Some people don't like that, but I guess it's something to help build the club on.
Something to build the club on. I personally don't like it either.
Yeah.
I don't like clubs that are going to, and our club is very proactive in the way that we're trying to do things. We're really trying to get back to the junior club at CB Complex. We have a few issues with the council, local council at the moment. And we're one of the clubs, and a lot of things that everyone's in the same boat, but we're proactive. We prefer to see promotion and relegation and give opportunities to other clubs and keep our standards up high so people keep working towards the same.
Yeah. Obviously, results let you down at times last season, but there were times during the season where you picked up some decent wins. And is it all about consistency in the NPL?
It is, well, it's about consistency at any level. The problem I have is we seem to get ourselves up for games against the higher rated clubs. And without being derogative towards other clubs, we played. There were teams last year or clubs behind us that would beat us, and that's where we killed us in the end. We could have had an opportunity. We should have finished sixth. Could have even finished fourth. So the opportunities there. We hopefully we'll rectify and work towards fixing this year.
Is it a challenge, I guess, for the club to bring juniors and NPL youth players here over a club like Magic or Olympic, or is that something the club's trying to work on their brand and sort of build up to be one of those sort of clubs that people want to play for?
Well, it's fairly simple, really. Your Broadmeadow Magics, your Hamilton Olympics, clubs of, and even Edgeworth, that stature, have no trouble accommodating and attracting young players. And the simple fact is one reason that their first grade squad's successful. And once this club starts getting successful in their first grade squad, people will want to come and play this. That's what we're aiming for.
Yeah. Oh, it's good catch up, mate. Good luck for the season.
Cheers, Ty. Cheers. Bye.
All right, we are back. Thank you to Darren Sills for that interview. I'd never met him before, so really, really nice guy, really nice coach, and all the best to Valentine FC. A lot of old friends and old faces from the first year of New Esports 2 years ago, back in New FM football, and I wish them well. Let's move on to Sunday's action, where there's only the one game that I knew about. There might have been games elsewhere, but Maitland versus Fortin Redbacks, Maitland FC, of course. I don't actually have any match review thing typed out yet, so I don't actually have my normal script as I normally would read out. I've got a picture of Roger Federer right there. What a performance it was tonight. It's now 12:50. I was up late. Well, not up late. I was just watching the tennis before. Great game. With Rafa Nadal, excellent. Let's talk about Maitland versus Fortin. The under 18s, which is under 19s for Fortin, of course. First of all, the idea to start this at 3:30, I wasn't very happy with it. I thought it was too late, you know, to sit around all day and wait for this game. I wasn't up till 11:30, to be completely honest with you. It was a late night last night watching Liverpool play Wolverhampton. Should be having my Wolves shirt on at the moment. Not a Wolverhampton fan, I just have a crap load of shirts. As you can tell with the Valentine and Edgeworth shirts from earlier. 3:30 start, I didn't know how this would work, but the cool change came just during 19s. The start of it was probably a bit hot for the players, but good conditions there at Cook Square Park. A nice, lovely ground to watch football at. Canteen a million miles away from the grandstand, but that's part of it, I guess. A bit of walking never hurts anyone. Alright, you may have noticed I may have changed positions here. This has been recorded after the end of the whole video, so I've just recorded this after to just place it in here because the under-18s game was one of our featured matches. Peter, our cameraman, our reliable cameraman, at it again. Hot day up there at Maitland, so thanks for the footage. We're going to go through this game again, the under-18s. I've already gone through it, but I went through it very quickly and I forgot that the highlights are going to be on there. So Harry Gordon missed two shots. I'm not going to put those in. Maitland could have scored a lot, I'm not going to lie, early on. Chances galore for Maitland in the 18s against Fortin's 19s. But they would score right on quarter time, which you're going to see right here. Maitland dominating. Isaac Hampson with the goal. Well worked goal here, as you can see. Really, really good goal. Probably the goal of the weekend for me. And the second quarter, played in quarters, of course, with a drinks break. I'd rather just call it quarter. It's much easier. Fourth minute in the second quarter, Harry Gordon across the goal to make it 2-0. 6 minutes later, it was 3-0, Jeremy Savage, as you can see here, with a really good finish. I say really good finish, I've got good finish here, so it might only be a good finish, I don't know. I don't actually remember it. You're seeing the vision, I'm not. I'm talking about it and putting it up at a later date. Then, 4-0 before half-time, Michael Foster, way too easy for Maitland. On fire, really, against a Fortin side that wasn't really up to the challenge on the day. We'll talk about Fortin soon. 15th minute of the third quarter was Matt Gardner's chance to make it 5-0 that he did. With his goal, 5-0 victory for Maitland. And I do admit I don't know too much about NPL teams, especially in the 18s, or I guess it was the 17s last year. But it is a very good team, I think, up there at Maitland. Obviously, playing Fortin isn't exactly playing Magic, Olympic, Edgeworth, you know, all those sort of teams. We'll see how they go. Obviously, a few of them would have gone on the the battalion tour over in France and England, which I was hearing a little bit about today. Great initiative there for Maitland, and yeah, that would have been a real good adventure, a real story to tell in the future. For Fortin, obviously there our focus here on new esports. We are new FM orientated, aren't we? Blake McDonald in goals, another decent game, and he's going to be vital for them this year. And this is the second time I'm recording this portion of the show, and I said it the first time and I'll say it again. Blake McDonald probably isn't given enough praise. If he was in a more defensively successful team, you know, last year Fortin in the lower grades really conceded a lot of goals. So if he's getting beat 4-5-0 some weeks, people don't really see exactly the work he does. The defensive line, correct me if I'm wrong, I'm probably going to be wrong, I should really check it. Gabe Halpin, I think, was one of the defenders. Caden Taylor, I know, was one of the defenders. Tristan Aspinall as well, at left back. And the right back, I have absolutely no idea. I'm reading through the team sheet at the moment. Two number eights, they've got to do something about that, Fortin. At least the team sheet was filled out this week, but you can't have two number eights. I'm looking through here, they don't have a number 18, you know, a piece of white or black tape, make a number 18 too easy. Nick Ryle and Shane Warden, both number 8s, luckily I can sort of tell the two apart, but it's not great, you know, I have to ask people which one's which and then try and remember. So yeah, not great for Fortin. Two new players as well. So we'll see how they go in the 19s. Obviously, there's a lot of movement between 17s and 19s. There's a lot of 17s players here. Just off the top of my head, McDonald, Taylor, Watkins, Aspinall, Warden as well. Those ones are just off the top of my head that definitely are still eligible for 17s. So. A lot of backing up at Fortin, a lot of new faces there too, so still coming together. And I did chat with one of the players afterwards about, you know, he just told me some things were good, but they gave away goals and that cost them in the end, and that was a fairly fair judgment. So that's that, that's the re-recorded bit, and I'll throw back to myself, I'll just cut in and cut out. On to the under-20s, here we go. In the under-20s, which was under-23s for Fortin, 10 minutes in, Regan Payne scoring over the goalkeeper, 1-0 Maitland. 20 minutes in, Tom Duggan, 2-0 Maitland, too easy. 3-0 Maitland, Ryan Broadley, easy again, and that's all before half-time. I don't actually have too much written on this sheet, but I will go further into it. Off the top of my head, I'll tell you right now, Fortin were just not good enough in the 23s/20s, whatever you want to call it. Poor defending. The communication of James Wand, the goalkeeper, just seemed like nobody was really listening to him at times. Over and over again, just saying the 25 still free, the 25 still free, and then next thing you know, the 25 gets the ball, gets an assist or whatever. They've definitely got to fix that for them. That's a real issue. They can't be doing that during the actual season. So they'll realise that mistake, I reckon, and fix that. 4-0, Lachlan Hodgetts, good player, actually. Very tall guy. Met his father, I think it's got something to do with Valentine. So I think that was him. Correct me if I'm wrong. Very tall winger, and looks like someone who's going to be decent at Maitland in this team. Good finish as well, very good finish. Penalty laid on to Fortin, Kieran Mason scoring that penalty, which was unfortunate for Maitland. I thought they deserved the clean sheet on the day. Let's talk about this Maitland team. Obviously I mentioned Ryan Broadley, who I believe is a long-term player there at Maitland, so interesting to see him in the 20s, I guess, there for experience. But Winston Oku is a new signing there. I believe he's signed on. If not, then he was definitely playing today. Good to see Winston. South Cardiff last year, Wall's End the year before. I had a feeling he went back to Wall's End, just a rumour. My own rumour, because I saw people I know from Wall's End adding him on Facebook, so that's how rumours start. Anyway, he's at Maitland, and he played in defence, which I don't think he did last year at South Cardiff. I know he didn't do it at Wall's End, and he was just solid in defence. Winston is a great player, someone who really watched up there at Maitland. Luke Jennings as well, the goalkeeper from Wall's End last year, has joined up with Maitland, so some interesting signings there. We'll flip over this page, we'll talk about first grade, which is probably not going to be good hearing for Fortin. They were defeated 4-0 by Maitland. Fortin, I thought, defended well against a very strong Maitland lineup. It took 30 minutes for the breakthrough to come, which against an NPL side, that's pretty decent. Carl Fortin was the goal scorer, and you know, if you're a new FM team and it takes 30 minutes for NPL side to score against you, and Carl Fortin's a guy who does it, you can't be too displeased with it. He's one of the best, been one of the best players in Newcastle for a few years now, Carl Fortin. I've always, during his time at Western, I thought he was a great player, and obviously I haven't seen too much of him at Maitland in the last couple of years. I don't see too much NPL football, but Carl Fortin, definitely a great player. 38th minute, so that was 30th, and then 38th minute, Ben Martin made it 2-0. Fortin just sort of collapsed here in the final 15 of the first half, which was unfortunate. Maitland controlled the game in the second half. 28th minute of the second half, again we'll have the highlights, so I can't read this out too quickly, can I? And I did for the 19, so apologies straight away, because that's going to be a complete mess. I might have to re-record that. Ben Martin made it 3-0 across goal. And then in the 37th minute, Ben Martin hit the post, as you'll see here. Very close to a hat-trick, hit the crossbar. And final 2 minutes of the game, Carl Fortin making it 4-0, and just a bit too easy for Maitland on the day, on the night, I should say. Maitland, very good team, and you know, obviously made the semi-finals last year. They'll be up there again, pushing for top four in my opinion. A couple of youngsters too, given a bit of a run today, which is good to see. For Fortin, not a great night, but I tell you what, Kyle Clark is going to be probably someone I mention a lot this year. Very good signing, very good in defence today, just a cool head to have in the team. It was a bit frustrating for Fortin. You could see the frustration, hear the frustration. Nathan McAllister, the captain, frustrated. Subert, frustrated. Josh Coleman, very frustrated at times. Not a good day for them, but again, you know, they're not going to be playing NPL oppositions each week. It's a learning curve, and I think Darren McAllister, he'll be pretty happy with another hit out. You know, it's better than not having a hit out and not getting any match fitness, and the result doesn't really matter at this time of the year. But I thought they handled it a bit better than some new FM teams I've seen play NPL. Singleton played Lakes the other night, and you know, without any disrespect to Singleton, I think Fortin played better than them today against Maitland. Maitland, of course, no disrespect to Lakes, but Maitland are better than Lakes, so you know, it's a day-by-day thing, NPL versus new FM. Trials, it doesn't really matter, but a good hit out for Fortin nonetheless. So that will pretty much wrap us up here. Apologies, because the 19s, or the 18s, I should say, it's not going to be great. I might actually refilm that after we finish this up here. I might just refilm that bit and go through it again. Just so I can manage to get enough time to show each goal. So that's that. This week, Monday, we got nothing. Tuesday, I'll be at Cohiba Six-a-Side, but that's not really a Nui Sports event. First game back at Cohiba for this year. Trying to get a bit of fitness. And we will be catching up with Cohiba next week, next Wednesday night, I'm hoping. That'll be uploaded next week. As for this week, what we're doing this week, originally Wednesday night we're heading over to the Black Butt Hotel to catch up with New Lambton, Adam Packer and Co, I guess. Some of the people alongside Andrew Packer. Adam Packer, Andrew Packer, how about that? He played in the freaking A-League, I should be getting his name right. Andrew Packer, the head coach of New Lambton, he did message me today and we've changed it to Thursday night, or they've changed it to Thursday, so we've gone to training instead, which works a lot better for me. Bit of training footage, catch up with some of the Eagles players, coaches, have a good night there. That's on Thursday, that'll be uploaded Friday, then Friday night, Hamilton versus Cooks Hill. Next Saturday, it's Westie versus Singleton. We will be doing interviews with Singleton. And then next Sunday, at the moment, is going to be Beresfield versus Cooks Hill. Possibly maybe change to Morissette versus Toronto, depending on what game I fancy when the time comes next week. A lot of football, a lot of interviews. Busy, busy time of the year. And that's that for this week. And considering it's 3 minutes past one in the morning, I'm actually very happy to be ending this video at this moment. No news around the club that are really worth mentioning in UFM. If there's any news, it'll be announced. If there's any top line news, there'll be something written about it. So that's pretty much that. Episode 7 of New Esports TV, and another thank you to the West Wall End Football Club for the interviews last week and having us out there. And it's a good initiative. I really enjoy these interview series and catching up with clubs. Even the one-off interviews like Darren Sills on Saturday, really enjoyable and good to just get out there and get to know people and feature those people on video. And that's what it's all about at the end of the day. I'm Ty7, I will see you in episode 8, the New Lambton feature, this Friday. See you then.